Welcome to worship here with us at St. Paul. It's a great evening to gather in our Lord's house to give thanks to Him and His goodness to us by sending His Son Jesus, the one to whom we receive all our life and salvation. We want to make you aware of two things. One, the hygiene drive is going on in the narthex. You can find that collection box there, and that is available for anyone to bring the items between now and March 6th. So take a look at that. It begins February 13th, I should say, to March 6th. So bring those in as you're able. Take a look to see what items are all needed as well. Our opening hymn is 477, Alleluia, Alleluia, Hearts to Heaven. We will stand on verse 3 of our opening hymn. God's blessings to you as we gather in our Lord's house. The bell will call us to worship. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared. Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon Him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. But together as His people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God our Heavenly Father, seeking His grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. We pause for a moment of silent reflection upon this, our confession of sin. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you. And for his sake, he forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous rules. Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with their whole heart. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes. Then I shall not be put to shame, having my eyes fixed on all your commandments. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous rules. We speak the Kyrie together. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O Lord, you bless the poor, the hungry, the weeping, and the persecuted. Mercifully hear the prayers of your people when they call upon you, and give us faith to believe your kingdom belongs to the humble of heart, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen. Congregation, may please be seated.
The Old Testament reading for the sixth Sunday after the Epiphany is from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 17. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart turns away from the Lord. He's like a shrub in the desert and shall not see any good come. He shall dwell in the parched places of the wilderness in an uninhabited salt land. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. He is like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the stream and does not fear when heat comes, for its leaves remain green and is not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. Now if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. This is the word of the Lord.
I invite you to please arise for the Alleluia in verse.
Alleluia.
Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 6th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And Jesus came down with the 12 and stood on a level place, with a great crowd of his disciples and a multitude of people from all Judea and Jerusalem and the sea coast of Tyre and Sidon, who came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured. And all the crowd sought to touch him, for power came out from him and healed them all. And he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you shall be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you shall laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you and revile you and spurn your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. for so their fathers did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you shall be hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. Woe to you when people speak well of you, for so their fathers did to the false prophets. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We join in making a bold confession of our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Hello, boys and girls. Today in the Old Testament reading of Jeremiah, God is talking about trees. Trees. Tell me about the parts. There's the trunk that holds the tree up. There's the branches that spread to the sky. There's the leaves up at the top that are green. And a lot of trees make fruit, apples, oranges, nuts. But today, the important part of the tree we're going to talk about are the roots. The roots go deep down into the soil, and that's how the tree gets its food and its water. That's also, the roots also protect it so it doesn't blow over in a windstorm. The first tree God talks about lives in a desert, and it tries to put its roots down, but they can't go very deep. And where it goes, there really isn't a lot of water, especially during the dry season. So the tree can't get water, can't get food, it shrivels up and dies. The second tree puts its roots down deep by a river, so it has lots of water and food, and even during drought, when there's not a lot of rain, it still has water, so it can still stay green and still can produce its fruit. Like some things in the Bible, God isn't just talking about trees. He's talking about you and me, people. We can be like the shrub, the tree in the desert, when we trust, when we put our roots, trust in man-made things, money, jobs, how smart we are, how strong we are, how many friends we have, how good we are at sports. But like that tree, when the tough times come, when there's problems, somebody's sick, your friends don't like you anymore, you flunk your test, those things don't really always help you. And you can kind of die, shrivel up inside and be like the dead tree. Or you can be like the green tree and we can trust Jesus. We can put our roots into Jesus. God loved us so much he sent Jesus to die on the cross. He always loves us and he has promised to always be with us and help us. We can really trust that. So the tough times are still going to come. Somebody could be sick, somebody could lose their job, you can flunk your test, but God will be with you and it'll work out. It'll be okay as long as you're trusting in Jesus. So how do we get those roots deep into Jesus? We need to hear his word. So either reading the Bible or having somebody read it to you, coming to church, going to Sunday school or Bible study, listening to God's word and music, all of those ways help us grow our roots deep into Jesus, into God, trusting God. So you need to choose, where are your roots going to be? Jesus, man-made things. Please pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for sending Jesus to die on the cross to forgive us. Thank you for loving us and promising to be with us. Thank you for having the Holy Spirit put faith in our hearts. Help us to grow our roots deep so that we always trust in you and in Jesus' love and forgiveness. Help us in the tough times so we can hang on to that like the roots of a tree. In your name, amen. Have a good day.
We continue with hymn 474, Alleluia, Jesus is risen. From our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text is that Old Testament passage just read from Jeremiah chapter 17. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. This is our text. This past weekend, I had the remarkable privilege of heading up to one of my favorite places, Camp Luther, Three Lakes, Wisconsin, spending time in the Great North Woods for our family winter retreat here through St. Paul. And so if you haven't had a chance to go up to Camp Luther, it's highly encouraged. You should do that. What a great opportunity and gem of our North Wisconsin District Ministry. While I was at camp one evening, we were headed into the dining hall, a beautiful new dining hall, and it caught my eye. Out of the corner, I looked, and there it was. I had to take a picture. And this was the photo I took. A tree by the lake with the sun setting behind it. And as I looked at that, I thought, wow, how beautiful, how majestic, how big, how towering. Also, I thought Jeremiah 17, blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. He is like a tree planted by water that sends its roots out by the stream. So as we think about this idea of the tree and what it is to be planted by the stream of living water, we meditate on that thought tonight and that picture Jeremiah gives to us through God's holy word. And so I invite you to join me in a prayer. Gracious God, open to us your word and cause us to deeply be planted and rooted in that word, a word of your grace and mercy, so we may withstand all that sin, death, and the devil throw at us in the day of scorching heat and freezing circumstances. For we live in a parched and barren land, and without the life-giving water of your word and sacrament, we would surely wither and waste away. Make us, O Lord, ever ready to trust you and your promises through your Son, Jesus Christ, that we may bear abundant fruit for you. Amen. The image of the tree. It's a powerful image in Scripture. And Jeremiah really wants us to think about the idea of what are you trusting in? It's a question we go take with us this week as we go our way. What are you trusting in? Jeremiah begins by posing the question, and it's a good one because it reaches into every corner of our heart and our lives, from the very littles who crawl to the elderly and aged and wise, to all in between. This question touches all of our hearts because it's truly a first commandment issue. Who or what do we put our trust in? We know the first commandment, you shall have no other gods, but the command is to trust and fear and love God alone. So it's not a matter if you have a God, but what is your God? Who is your God in identifying that God? Jeremiah doesn't make it explicit in this section of Scripture, but it's thought that the person referred to, the one who trusts in himself, might actually be King Zedekiah. He is one of the last kings of Judah before Judah is carried off into captivity. Zedekiah and Jeremiah have had interaction, and Zedekiah is trusting in Egypt, and Egypt fails them. Instead of trusting in the Lord, they put their trust in Egypt. And not only in Egypt, but Judah and Israel trust in their own gods, the things that they put their hope in. You remember back to the Exodus story, the account where Moses is up on Mount Sinai, and he's away, and the people say to Aaron, make us gods that will go before us. And they throw gold in the fire, and poof, out comes this calf. They have resorted to idolatry. And this isn't just a one-time instance. No, Jeremiah 17 says it's engraved on their hearts. The path is entrenched. They are prone to doing this. And so are we. We're prone to leave God and his word in our lives, to chase after other gods, to put our trust in something else. Great power and influence this person has, who is blessed by the Lord, who trusts in other things. As we think about the one who trusts in his own flesh, that trust only leads to one thing. Destruction. Destruction for the people of Judah. They're carried off into captivity in 586 BC. Totally destroyed. They are destroyed because their trust was in their self. So this is the situation to which the prophet is speaking. This is the context in which the word comes to us tonight. The one who is cursed and the one who is blessed. The one who's like a withered tree, the one who's like a tree that puts out its roots. Quite the contrast as we think about these two types of trees. The tall, mighty, leafy tree, or the dry, barren, dead tree in the desert. You might think Texas, mesquite tree. You might think Arizona, Southwest, juniper, tumbleweed. You might think South Dakota, tumbleweed, blown across the prairie. Whatever tree it is that's in your head, rootless, shallow, no connection, no source of water, no source of life. This is the picture of the one who trusts in himself, not just King Zedekiah, not just Judah and Israel, but each and every one of us. We are prone to trust in our own prosperity, our own power, our own possessions. What a place. This is the dry and barren wasteland of our lives. Take note. Who wants to live in Death Valley? Who wants to live in a place that is without roots and without water? We think about what it is to live in such a place. The person who trusts in himself looks a certain way. They are cursed under God's wrath. They are mortal, prone to death. Thirdly, they are putting a trust in themselves, and they don't even recognize when good things come their way. They are a dead tree, lost in the ability to discern between what is good and what is not. And so God points us to another tree, a second tree in the text. It's a confident tree. It's a leafy tree. It's a well-watered tree. You may be thinking Psalm 1, and many of our writers in antiquity have pointed Jeremiah 17 to Psalm 1. Blessed is the man who walks in the way of the Lord. He's like a tree planted by streams of water. That's the picture of those who trust is in Yahweh, in the God of Israel, the one who allows them to be planted by streams of living water. Psalm 92 tells us, the righteous will flourish like a palm tree. They will grow like a cedar of Lebanon, planted in the house of the Lord. They will flourish in the courts of God. They still bear fruit in old age. They will stay fresh and green, proclaiming, the Lord is upright. He is my rock, and there is no wickedness in him. What kind of tree is this? Its leaves are leafy. They're green. They're put out. They bear fruit. They flourish in the courts of God. How does one flourish in the courts of God? Well, the word that Jeremiah gives us is a Hebrew word, and it means to be transplanted. The word is shatuled. If you want to say it, go ahead, say it with me. Shatuled. The tree is shatuled. It's transplanted. Now, I've never met a plant that has said, give me that spade and let me take a hold of it and uproot myself and put myself over here. No, the plant doesn't have that ability. The master gardener must plant and transplant it in order for it to survive. That's the picture of the one who trusts in the Lord, the one who's been transplanted by the water. And for us, dear friends, it's the waters of our baptism, the flowing waters of God's means of grace in our lives. We've been brought to those waters by the master gardener, the one who cares for us, who gives us his own life in the midst of death. We are the ones who have roots because we are connected to the source of life, the one who gives us his very life, the one who puts out roots in every direction because they're in the right place, in the house of the Lord. That's where the tree flourishes, in the courts of God, in the house of God. That's where the tree finds itself. As I was at Camp Luther this weekend, you may have seen a preview. I actually came upon another tree. On the wall are lined all sorts of photos of the camp staff. And the one that caught my eye was the very first photo, 1977. It's the big birch, I'm assuming it's a birch tree, a big tree. And it's filled with people, the camp staff. From 1977 to 2022, there are camp staff pictures on the wall, and not all of them have this tree, but a good majority of them do. And you can notice that the tree is leafy. And I'm not just talking about the vegetation. I'm talking about the people, the ones who fill that tree, because they are planted in the Lord. They are blessed because they are not trusting themselves. They're putting their lives in the hands of the one who's given his life for them. They are serving because they have been served. They're at the ready to do what 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2 says. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, encourage with great patience and instruction. Ever leafy, ever green. That doesn't mean that we're not going to have hardship and trouble in life, but it means that when we do, we have the proper space to take on those things. You have the capacity to deal with troubles like sickness and death because you are connected to the tree of life. On that Good Friday, Jesus gave us another tree, a tree that he was cursed upon. He was cursed for us that we might be blessed in him. Well, you know the tree I'm talking about. It's the tree that gives us everything we need. God's mercy and grace, his acceptance, the fact that he takes care of our shame and our disgrace, and he nails it to that tree. He took on our sin and our punishment for us to show us truly the gravity of God's love for us. Jesus himself hung on this tree. Cursed is everyone who's hung on a tree, Galatians 3:13 tells us. This tree is the tree we deserve. The tree we get is the tree of life. We're not tumbleweeds anymore. We're towering oaks. We are a planting of the Lord. We trust in him who puts us in his courts. And so for 149 years in this place, we have been rooted in Christ and established in his love. So what are you trusting in today? Where is your hope? Is it in you or is it in him? Some trust in chariots and some trust in horses, the psalmist says, but we will trust in the name of the Lord our God. We trust in Jesus all our days. Amen. And now may that peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard our hearts and our minds in Christ. Amen. We stand as we continue with the prayer of the church. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Celebrating the presence of the Lord in our midst, we pray for an increase of the word, asking that God's messengers may continue to speak with power among us, bringing us the good news of sins forgiven in Christ alone. Blessed Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer and grant our supplication. Plant us like trees by living waters, that we bear the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. By your Spirit, direct our lives that we live as God's holy people. Blessed Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer and grant our supplication. Grant that your blessing of peace be experienced throughout the world, and that we as your peaceable people shine brighter with the light of your love. Blessed Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer and grant our supplication. In this time of prayer, we also make our petitions for the sick, the shut-in, and all who this day are in need of our intercession, that their prayers may be soon answered, and that they may be supported by God's people with care in the name of Christ. Blessed Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer and grant our supplication. Grant that we be numbered among the blessed who bring aid to the poor, food to the hungry, comfort to the sorrowing, and hope to the despairing. Blessed Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer and grant our supplication. With gratitude, we remember those sisters and brothers in Christ whose earthly journeys are finished, and who now enjoy the promised Sabbath rest. Grant that we be guided in ways that honor their earthly lives as we anticipate the heavenly life that is to come. Blessed Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer and grant our supplication. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Goes beyond.